And, all right, so we're here to talk about the Inhumans.
Yeah.
How many of you, when you heard Inhumans, you know, in the Marvel phase, what is that, three? Is that phase three? What? Three?
Yeah.
Yeah, phase three announcement. When they said Inhumans, you went, what the fuck?
I don't do that anymore. I don't do that with Marvel anymore.
You don't do that. You're like... Yeah, we already had the talking raccoon, yep. So yeah.
Talking raccoon, guy with the powers of an ant, fuck it, do whatever you want. Yeah,
we got it.
I'm sorry, but can we swear?
Well, I don't think we can help it with the group that's up
okay,
here.
Okay, let's not swear. Can let's introduce.
Yeah,
let's introduce.
Yeah, McCord.
All right.
God.
So let's get this panel started. My name is J.C. Carter. I'm moderating this panel because it was my idea, and for once I get to moderate my own idea. My name is J.C. Carter. I'm the host of Hold 322, the world's greatest comic book podcast, available on iTunes, Stitcher, and everywhere else in the world. And sitting next to me, we've got...
I'm Shannon Barnson from the Geek Show Podcast. It's a podcast.
It's a podcast. It does those things.
I'm Trent Hunsaker, Death Ray Comics, and Smodcast.com.
Yeah.
Yeah.
McCord Larsen, I'm a writer and producer for Olympus Media International.
What's up, y'all? I'm Jay Whittaker. I'm also on the Geek Show podcast with Shannon. So yeah, that's cool.
We split an Uber today.
Yeah, we did.
Yeah.
He had his little recycled bags, and we got in a minivan. Some lady named Melissa dropped us off, and we had a good time. So yeah, follow us on Twitter, Geek Show Shannon, and then Token J Twitter. Token like black dude, J like J-A-Y. Super easy. Yeah, check us out. Thanks.
3 years and that joke still works on me every time.
I was gonna say, it's the way that people remember it.
Yeah.
I will say, at least tomorrow you're doing one presentation where you won't be the token black guy.
Exactly.
There's gonna be two of you.
Yeah.
Is it Saturday?
Saturday.
Yep. I don't know what day it is.
All right. So as the radioactive professor of all things comic book, when they announced Inhumans, of course, my mind went way back to 1965. And when Stan, well, let's just say it was Jack,
because
by that point, Stan really wasn't doing much. So Jack Kirby introduced this weird group of people who lived in this hidden city in the Himalayas called Adelin. Is that how you say it?
Attila? I would say Attila.
And I would say Atalan.
Yeah,
I've heard Atalan. That's what.
Plus, it sounds.
All right, somebody is going to get it right one of these days, and we'll all say it a different way. He introduces this
city.
When
we see the movie, we'll be like,
That's how you do it.
So
we said they'll be like, the rest of the guys on that panel were assholes.
I say we leave it up to the audience. Let's announce the three and just we do a round of applause.
All right.
Yeah.
So Adelin.
Golf claps for Adelin. Okay.
Golf clap, okay, good.
Attila.
And then Atalan.
All right. Ladies and gentlemen, it is now Atalan.
Okay, so
sorry,
Atalan.
Marvel, they spoke.
It sounds exotic.
Yeah. So I introduced this place called Atalan, where everybody, we meet the royal family.
That just sounds weird.
Yeah, I know. This is how Trent hears it in his head. Doesn't sound right in real life. So we meet this royal family. They're all wearing superhero costumes, which was kind of weird.
Royal family of Atalan.
The royal family of Inhumans at Atalan, with Black Bolt, whose real name is Blackagar Boltagon.
Yep.
Yeah. Right? Yeah.
Lucky for him.
Yeah.
I didn't say I had much imagination when I created these characters. I just said they had imagination.
I feel like if Hulk Hogan was actually named
Hulkanus.
And then you had his queen, Medusa.
What was her real name, smart guy?
Medusalina Boltagon. I'm dead fucking serious.
That's progressive. She took his last name.
Yeah, she took his last name. And then we had her sister,
Crystal.
Slut.
Yep.
Jeez.
The only one really did.
We've all got the hots for Johnny Storm, okay?
Yeah, we do. Then we had... Karnak, who could break anything and had a great big head.
Except my heart.
Now, I thought he was that guy that could predict.
Yeah, that was Johnny Carson.
Oh, okay.
I think Stan was.
That was good. You guys aren't giving him props for that.
Dude. That was good.
It's well timed and well played.
You gotta go back in time for that one.
Sis Boom Bomb.
Back when we.
What does this. What does a sheep say after it swallows dynamite?
And you had Gorgon, who had hooves. For no apparent reason, he was called Gorgon with hooves, and he could break things with his hooves.
Yeah,
he was cool.
He could create.
And then Triton, because you gotta have the fish guy.
Sure.
Right. Yeah.
And then Lockjaw, who's one of all time.
Lockjaw.
I love that he was a dude.
Just a big old dog?
Well, he was a dude, yeah. Right?
Like Cobra Commander, he was once a man.
Yeah.
And then the Terrigen Mist hit him, he turned into a giant bulldog.
And they feed him dog food now.
They do.
It's the worst.
Maybe he was an a-hole.
That's the one thing about the Terrigen Mist that kind of just pisses me off. It's like a crapshoot.
Yeah, it really is.
There should be no casinos on that planet. And I was just like, what's the point of gambling? Because you're just going to do the Terrigen Mist.
House
thing.
Always wins.
Right?
House always wins with the Terrigen Mist. Black Bolt.
Cool, I've got a butthole for a mouth.
Yeah, Black Bolt looks all cool and awesome, and then all of a sudden he can't talk ever, and he's the king. He can never speak. He's the king who never speaks. Because if he speaks, he will level the city.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. Medusa's hair is living. Which means she can never get a haircut or a dye job, apparently.
Actually, she can get a haircut, but what's cool is she can actually continue to control her hair after it has been cut.
Yeah.
What? You mean you can get your hair did and still control it? What?
It's also razor sharp.
That's a good hairdresser. All
right, so here's the deal.
Little kids just walked in. Just like...
From 65 on, we only ever saw the royal family. There was a whole city full of Inhumans that could have come to Earth or hung out in the United States in New York.
And where are they from?
Himalayas originally, and then they went to the blue area of the moon.
Yes.
And that city was called?
Ottilan.
Ottilan. What? What is it?
Ottawa.
Ottawa.
It's actually Ottawa. Based off of...
Why are y'all talking about the Autobahn?
It's true. It's weird.
Okay, we're doing
it. It makes more sense that way.
So they went. We never saw another Inhuman except for the royal family. And
do we see Maximus? Do we know Maximus?
Yeah, we have Maximus, but then isn't he still part of
his family?
The family,
because he's the prince.
He's Maximilian Boltagon.
That's so stupid.
It's ridiculous. Anyway, I just love it. I love how he was Maximus the Mad.
Yeah.
So there were a royal family in superhero suits.
Mad Maximus.
If you're gonna be a royal family, how badass would it be to see the queen in the Flash outfit nowadays?
Yeah,
she goes out and she's just waving a little bit. She puts her hood on. It'd be great.
It'd be awesome.
I'm all for it.
I would support that completely.
Is it the Queen of England? She has superpowers?
Yeah. No, she doesn't have superpowers. She dresses up like she does.
Oh, it's God's imagine she just give anybody osteoporosis that she wants to.
So then we hit this century, and Fox starts selling off their properties, right? Marvel starts selling off their properties to different film studios. Fox buys the X-Men, which means they get all the mutants.
I love this.
And so they were like, well, what do we have? We've got to have mutants when Marvel Films started up. We've got to have mutants. Can we get them back from Fox? And Fox is like, you could back up a truckload of money, but we've got four of those in the back already that we're not going to give up these characters for. And so they said, well, what do we got? Inhumans?
I was talking to Jay about this on the lift on the way here.
Uber, thank you.
Uber, whatever.
The Uber.
And Marvel's just like, so they're not going to give us back the mutants?
No, you don't give them back.
All right, let's just kill them.
Yep.
Let's kill all of them.
Spoiler.
Inhumans are the mutants now.
Yep. No, something interesting about that is I don't know how they escaped with the Inhumans in the first place, because with those rights went the Fantastic Four rights.
Right.
Oh,
yeah.
Right.
And for the first 30 years of the Inhuman history, they only appeared in Fantastic Four. Comics.
Their first appearance was Fantastic Four number 45.
How did they do that?
They're as much as they're as much part of the Fantastic Four franchise as, say, the Shi'ar is to the X-Men franchise.
Sure. Yeah. That's totally true.
And I don't know how they got away with it.
To me, there's important to the Fantastic Four franchise as Silver Surfer, and they got
that. Oh, absolutely. Yeah. And Galactus.
And they got those guys. So, yeah.
Yeah, so I don't know how they escaped with those rights in the first place.
But they got them. And so now
luckily, Fox aren't big comic readers.
Right? One guy was just like...
made that obvious.
Wait, hold on. This one dude's a giant bulldog that can teleport? Stupid. Let's not paint me. Let's go back to this.
He was a dude once?
No.
What? No, they're making me dog food. Let's not buy that.
No. We're a dog. dog-friendly company.
So Marvel's all, let's kill off the mutants slowly, but of course you've got a ton of X-Men fans who still read the comics and want those guys to stick around, so they're doing their best to keep them, but they're still trying to kill them off at the same time, which is killing me. It's cracking me up.
I actually disagree with that assessment. I can see where people are coming from, but even as far back as the 80s and 90s, almost every top-selling X-Men crossover series has to do with them on the brink of extinction. The Legacy Virus, Zero Tolerance,
True.
Days of Future True. Past, and then even House of M, and then coming back up. So, I mean, I can see it's just a cycle repeating over.
Mutant Massacre, all that good stuff.
Like, why are they always in a crisis? Like, I mean, like, why can't they just go to, like, a barbecue and Jubilee does some fireworks and it's all good?
Because that's a boring story.
Right? Yeah, like, I just want a happy episode.
They had that once in the...
book.
Yeah, the X-Men had that life once, and the team consisted of a guy who looked like a fish who, for some reason, befriended like a half-powered juggernaut, and that was a good reason to kill him off.
But you're right, though.
And then that happened.
There's definitely been, though, some culling that I think has definitely pointed towards this. Point in case, look at the new origin that we just found out in the Magneto comic, of
Quicksilver and
Scarlet Witch. Yeah, they're Inhumans.
They're Inhumans. They're not his children. Like
they've rewritten history.
For like 50 years, they said they're his kids, and now they've decided, no, we're going to retcon that. They're not his kids.
If I was Magneto, I would magnetize all the child support I just paid. And back. Yeah, give it in coins. Nickel doesn't magnetize, by the way.
Well, now isn't what's going on in Marvel like the Terrigen Mist or like Super Terrigen Mist? And if
it's a Terrigen cloud that goes around the Earth
and kills mutants,
and Medusa and her people have to follow the Terrigen cloud and find new Inhumans that get born from it. It's poisonous to mutants, they've said. So if a mutant if it comes in contact with a mutant, they're dead. So that, again, are they killing off the mutants?
And the only thing I would say no is in October, September, October, sweeps for comics.
Yeah.
Extraordinary X-Men, all new X-Men, all new Uncanny X-Men. I think there's like 5 X titles.
All the characters you love are coming back.
There's at least one X title that has not been announced yet.
Yeah, so they're still around, but I don't know. We'll see how much fanfare they do.
And then like Marvel Heroes today, or this weekend, I think Marvel Heroes, the next playable character is Kitty Pryde. The Kotobuyuko, I don't know how to say that, the statue company just put out an Uncanny X-Men line with Cyclops and the Frost Magic and Magneto. They just announced HeroClix of X-Men in 2016. They're still there.
I agree with you. I don't think they're going anywhere.
Yeah.
I don't think you're going to lose any of these major characters, but at the same time,
Marvel's really going...
They're
hey, look at these!
Humans.
Yeah, totally. Yeah.
And personally, I love it because, like, I mean, and I, if you guys disagree with me, I don't care. but I mean, like, it's kind of time for like the X-Men to just kind of be pushed aside and just like let Inhumans come in and do this thing, because I mean, we all, I'm pretty sure by a round of applause, who's super familiar with the X-Men? Okay. Now, who's super familiar with Inhumans?
Three of us.
Like, exactly. No, that's the point.
Do I remember who my husband is?
I'm well aware of that situation, but I mean, I'm just, the whole point is I'm trying to say is like, it's not, the Inhumans, they're great, and now they're bringing them to the forefront. This is like their time, you know, it's our time down here, Goonies moment. Like, and
it really is.
And it's so great, because I think it's time for us to get something new and just get this other culture of the Marvel Universe that is not looked at.
Well, that's going along, right, with everything else they're doing in the comic books, is post-Secret Wars, it's all about the legacy.
Yeah.
So it's about all these new characters taking on new roles, new mantles. The Falcon is now Captain America. Jane Foster is now Thor. Sam's Nova. Miles Morales is now Spider-Man. And the Inhumans are kind of the legacy to the X-Men.
Well, and it's and like finger on the button, their comic is now the Uncanny Inhumans.
Yeah.
Like, but that's the name of the comic, and the Beast is helping them.
Yes.
But they had the title Uncanny before the X-Men did.
Ooh.
The first time.
Oh wow,
that's true.
Look at everybody learning stuff. Everyone's like, I saw somebody go,
Wow. Here's what I'm going to say is the best thing about the Inhumans.
Yeah.
They've made Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. watchable.
Oh. Yes.
Ugh. I see a lot of people like halfway clapping, they're like, they don't want to clap, but they're like, damn it, he's
right.
Come on,
he's
even
right.
If you liked it when it was terrible, now you're like, this is way better.
Now you're like, okay to like okay. You, you can tell your friends that you watch it.
It's even better now.
No, but I,
that's for sure.
I think what makes the Inhumans so special is just frankly their king, Black Bolt. I mean, who's read World War Hulk?
Great.
And anybody remember? Was it Planet or World War where they send Black Bolt in? When he's fighting on the moon.
Yeah, Hulk goes to the moon.
And they go toe to toe.
Yeah.
And like, you know, whether you want to like, I don't want to get into debate, but if you're gonna mention top five dead or alive, Black Bolt is in there as far as like where he's at. And so, and dude held his own. I mean, and so, and then you think about, what am I thinking of? Old Man Logan.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
Black Bolt's still there. He's chilling, just chilling. Like, yeah, what's up? I'm kind of with Emma Frost. We're trying to work it out.
So now we get into the cinema part of it, where they start sneaking them in with, I think we got hints even before S.H.I.E.L.D. I think we even got hints as far back as Thor the Dark World.
Do tell.
That we were going to start seeing Inhumans.
Okay.
And now we're going to get... And then, of course, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. really brought them in. And once we learned that Skye's first name really was Daisy, that told me she was really Quake, which is... She's actually a mutant in the regular Marvel Universe.
Kind of.
But they've decided, no, she's Inhuman. And they've made her Inhuman and given her the same powers as Daisy Johnson in the comic books. So that's cool. So now here we are, ready to start something up. But the problem is Inhumans doesn't come out until 2019?
Right. Yeah.
So
we have so much to do.
4 years of S.H.I.E.L.D. being able to do whatever they want with this society. Now we've only seen, what's the name of the, I wrote it down so I wouldn't forget. Afterlife. We've seen Afterlife, which is sort of Shangri-La for the Inhumans. It's not Attilan, Atalan.
Atalan.
Atalan. It's not those.
Autobahn.
We
don't know.
I thought Afterlife looked cool. It looked like, what is it called? Beaches, like the all-inclusive spa.
It was.
It's sandals.
Sandals. It's club bed for Inhumans.
Come to Afterlife.
Come to Afterlife.
Come to Afterlife.
You're gonna get exposed to these mists. You might have a butthole for a mouth. You don't know.
Yeah. But you got all the
drinks.
You.
All the drinks and the food is free.
We'll take care of you. It's a crapshoot, dude.
Yeah,
we'll figure out how to eat.
Yeah.
It's like free drinks at the casino.
Everything you will eat from now on is a suppository. Sorry, it's just the way it is.
That's what would happen to me. Like if I got exposed to the terrors of mists, I would just all. I'd be like.
You can already... speak. You're not like Black Bolt. You can speak. You just wouldn't want to.
That's the one thing that just still blows my mind. I mentioned it earlier, but it really is a crapshoot. Like, because is it based on your personality or anything?
No,
it's just,
not really.
It's a genetic.
Sometimes a writer. It depends on who's writing it. Always. It always depends on who's writing the comic. Sometimes a writer will base it on their personality, and other times, no, it's a crapshoot. They give them whatever they want. And butthole for mouth. Gordon, good example.
Yeah.
Is he Lockjaw effectively at this point? I mean,
no, because he's
dead
giant
now.
Dog.
So he's not a giant dog and he's dead.
Yeah.
But still, he had that. He could have been. He could be the precursor in a way to get us ready for Lockjaw. But to be
who would just love it, like you're watching Agents of the S.H.I.E.L.D. and there's just a throwaway scene at the end where they walk in and there's a giant bulldog and he's standing there and it teleports a bunch of people away. And all of us that know, would be like,
holy crap.
I'd have a heart attack.
Like,
yeah,
just
make a mess of my couch. To the nerdgasm I would have
right.
over that.
But then people, like, I work with girls who watch the show at the set, and they'd be like, they'd come to me the next day and go, what the hell was that giant bulldog? Why did it have a tuna and fork on its hand.
I think you
well, Darby Ray Crawford, let me tell you.
Their minds just go upside down. You're like, he was actually a guy.
He was a guy.
He was a dude. Yes.
It's so absurd, and I love it. Like that's the thing. It's so absurd, and I absolutely love it. What is that? What was his name again?
Blackagar Boltagon.
Blackagar's better, though.
Blackagar is better, but Blackagar.
Blackagar! What's up? You can't even go up to a girl. What's up? Hey, how you doing, man? What's up? My name's Blackagar. You know.
Jay, I have a new challenge for you.
During calling in Sharpie, I'll write Blackagar Whittaker. That's the Blackagar Whittaker. What is Heligar?
Black of God. Like imagine that on a presidential banner. Black of God and Medusa. 2016.
You're
not even better. Black of God, Crystal. Like super easy. Man.
Yeah, Crystal.
Oh, yeah.
All right.
Is that a Sharpie? Who's got a Sharpie? I want a Sharpie. You got a Sharpie?
I've got eyeliner.
You got
eyeliner?
Give me that Blackagar Sharpie.
Blackagar demands your eyeliner.
Toss it. Thank you.
Good job, Kat.
All right.
How do I spell this?
Blackagar. I believe it or not, I am a school teacher.
B-L-A-C-K-A-G-G-A-R.
Blackagar.
Blackagar, yeah. No, that's really it, yeah.
Blackagar Whittaker.
Whittaker.
How much are you charging for your autograph?
Huh? Which name you want me to sign?
It's free double. If it's Blackagar.
It's double if it's Blackagar. Twice as much
money. Yeah. Let's go get matching tattoos.
Right?
You get Blackagar, I'll get White as Heligar. Bart Sonigar.
I kind of want to call my mom and just be like, hey, I appreciate everything you did for me, but I will no longer be referred to as my slave name. I will now fully take on my heritage and go forth as Black God.
That would be your inhuman heritage?
I put that shit on a resume. What's up? Black God, give me the job!
McCord, before we got started.
I'm sorry, we got way off track.
Let me moderate.
McCordagar!
I'm having too much fun, too. McCord, before we got started, you were telling me about a preview for S.H.I.E.L.D.
Yes. Did anybody see the clip earlier today? For season 3, the opening sequence for season 3? For S.H.I.E.L.D.?
Okay. So walk us through it.
All right, so essentially, it opens up, and this guy's apartment is essentially torched. There's a half of a person standing in his kitchen that's completely charred. There's things just steaming and smoking all over the place, and this guy's he gets up and he runs out of his apartment and he's just kind of freaking out, and everything he like puts he goes to the fire escape and it starts melting, and everything he does is just he's just creating this heat around him, and he's on the run. This Black Force Ops...
Black or God Force.
This Black Ops team...
I'm so sorry.
The Black Agar Ops team... they come in like a SWAT team, surround this guy, and he's just screaming, I'm sorry, I don't know what's happening, I don't know what I'm doing, I'm not dangerous, I just need help. And they pull their guns, and it comes over the radio, use lethal force if necessary. And he says, lethal force, I didn't do anything, I didn't do anything. And they tell him to put his hands on the car, and as soon as he does, not only that car, but two other cars to the side of him explode. And it knocks over the guys, he runs into a back alleyway, and he's cornered. And then pretty soon we see these shock waves come and clear out those soldiers. And everything starts shaking.
I know who did it.
Yeah. Hey, smoke. There's a smoke bomb. Daisy slash Sky shows up, Hunter shows up, and Max show up. And Daisy walks over and just simply says, "Hey, we understand. This has been a crazy day for you. We understand you just need help. Stay with us." And this big, like, floating room just appears out of nowhere, just, like, descends in the alleyway.
Are you sure you really saw this?
Oh, man, absolutely.
Dude, I think I dreamed this.
Is this a whole movie? This is amazing.
I know.
Like, don't stop! Then what?
I said this in an earlier panel. We should hang out more.
I licked a toad right before.
It was the mother toad.
Oh, yeah.
This is so good. You guys should be periscoping right now.
Yeah. The doors open, and Max simply says, "Because this day just can't get weirder, right?" And he's like, "Well, I guess." They close the door, and the thing just takes off into the sky. And he's screaming, "I was wrong, I was wrong." And then Sky and her team kind of deal with the situation. And then it shows the guy, and he just keeps going up and up and up. And then it shows one of their little Quinjets flying above, and the intercom comes on the room, and it's Max saying, "You all right in there?" And he's like, "I hope this is going someplace rather than up." And he's like, "Don't worry, we're getting close." And then it reconnects with the bus, right? It comes into the bus. Then it goes back to the ground, and it shows some woman in a limousine pull up and is rebuking the soldiers for letting her get away and causing so much noise and publicity, and the fact that there was a helicopter involved, and she was really upset, and Coulson's in the crowd taking pictures of them all. And she talks about how important it is that they don't get discovered, and then it ends. I mean,
can we applaud that? McCord would make a great eyewitness.
Exactly.
He'd be like, it was Black Azar, and his buddy, White Caucasian Azar, was crazy.
What is Heligar?
What's Heligar?
Oh, sorry. That's like a...
You
don't have to now.
Yeah, but by the way, when everyone leaves this room, don't walk out of here and go up to the first black person you see and be like, "Black of God." Don't do that, please. Like, because then I'll get in trouble, I'll get an email.
That'd be bad, okay?
Yeah. Be next, you'll be the representative for Utah.
Yeah, this stays in this room, okay?
So,
well, you know, Jay, I've always said I like my coffee like I like my Inhumans.
Black of God.
Black of God and mutated.
Definitely go to Starbucks.
Perfect for your butthole mouth. So, hearing McCord's description, an eyewitness account of such things, now my first thought was, how are they going to screw that up?
Come on, I don't know.
Three episodes before they screw it up, what's the bets, you know? But I'm excited that the Inhumans are being brought into this. At one point, Matt Fraction was going to take over writing Inhumans, and he bailed on it to write Sex Criminals, which I think was a wise career choice after I read Sex Criminals.
Absolutely.
But he was thinking of having the Inhumans do a whole Game of Thrones kind of thing with the royal family. That story still is out there, and so could that be the Inhuman movie? Now we get the fun of speculating on what the Inhuman movie will be.
Gonna chime in here.
So, yes. Oh, McCord's probably read the script already.
Scene one.
Tell us everything you need to know.
Scene 13. Dim the lights. Amazing. It was a dark and stormy night. One of the Inhumans so far the Inhumans that we have seen in the book, aside from Daisy Johnson, or in the show, aside from Daisy, have not been people that we've seen in the comics before. I don't know why Gordon had no eyes and
wasn't for reader. Gordon, except for Gordon, Gordon being a precursor for Lockjaw.
Dr. Jekyll, Mr. Hyde, but that's like, not.
Well, that's Mr. Hyde. Yeah. Never been an Inhuman. Yeah.
Yeah. And he didn't claim to be in the show either. Mm-hmm. He just fell in love with one. That's true. But one of the characters that they have announced that is actually a new human created by Charles Soule is Lash. And Lash is essentially the Inhumans version of Magneto.
Yeah.
So, he's kind of a Magneto-Apocalypse amalgamation where he believes only certain people are worthy to hold the title of Inhuman and have gone through the teragenesis, is what they call it.
Yeah.
And he's the only one, and then he kills everybody he doesn't think is worthy.
Yeah, so, I mean, kind of taking from Afterlife a little bit, where not everyone gets to go through the teragenesis.
Exactly, because that's the traditional way. Now, for those of you who don't know, the Inhumans get their the Inhumans were experimented on millions of years ago at the dawn of civilization by the Kree, which they
effectively they were Neanderthals being experimented on.
Yeah, as
a Kree. Right. Yeah. So yeah. But now it's a genetic trace that's passed on through heritage. So if you have this, then if you come into contact with this type of crystal, you like Jay said, it's a complete crapshoot.
Black or gone. Thank you.
there truly is an Inhuman that's a living door.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you never know what you're going to get. But it's a rite of passage, and it's something very sacred and religious traditionally to the Inhumans. Now, in the comics, it was a cloud. Now, the teragenesis, if you saw Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., you will know that it is now in the water supply. So anybody who's drinking the water that has this gene is going to just wake up and freak out with who knows what kind of power.
My butthole's in my face.
Right.
What the heck? I just took my krill oil. What's wrong with me?
So I do believe that we're going in that direction.
Yeah.
Where there's going to be these two kind of houses of ideas, much like the X-Men, where there's going to be this fraction that's like, okay, we need to make peace with the humans. We need to help them, and the other one who thinks that they are the superior race and that there's only certain few of them that should be there. So not only do they have humans hunting them, they have these inhuman fanatics hunting them as well, all going against the royal family.
Yeah, and I you reminded me of what they started calling themselves. What was that? New humans?
New humans. Yeah, it's like shoegaze, but in the 2000s.
Yeah, so they started calling themselves new humans because they came from the genetic trace rather than being purebred inhumans. So we've had this story before, where you're of a pure breed or you're of a half breed, right? And the pure breed is the one that the pure breeds think that they should move forward. We see that in Harry Potter. We see that in vampire novels. We see that everywhere, you know. And then you have the half breed or the human breed, which
Muggles.
Are the Newmans.
We see it in Congress.
Drake.
In history.
In and of itself, in history. Yeah, so, and we could get that cult Game of Thrones thing going down with that kind of factioning happening with
this.
It's
really loud next door. I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
It's only you know, activating your ADD. That's okay.
I would propose this. I mean, a story of that magnitude is going to be fairly big and take, you would think, multiple movies to tell.
Or 4 years of television series.
Okay, now, and that's what I'm saying. Do you think that, I mean, and everyone always says, ooh, is the Marvel bubble going to burst? We don't know. Is this still going to be a thing in 2019? Like, will people still be stoked to see an Inhumans movie? Or will they be like, you mean that stupid movie on ABC, that show? That
the stupid
so
shield?
Dog that shows up with a tuning fork and they feed it dog food?
I think, you know, as we mentioned, if we go the Game of Thrones route, I think that's a safe way to play it. But, I mean, like, frankly, not a lot of people really know about the Inhumans. So it's just, they can still tell the story, kind of get away with some breathing room, and I think they'll be just fine.
Well, but Marvel's like super good. Like, I mean, come on, man. Yeah. Like I said, they made an Ant-Man movie that was really good. they made a Guardians of the Galaxy movie that was amazing.
That
right?
Was amazing.
So they're really good at finding somebody that, or people, right, that can go, hey, I really like this property, or this is what I think the core of this property is, and I'm going to take that and I'm going to expand on it and make it palatable to people who might go, well,
it's a
bulldog, right? They're really good at that, where you just go, yeah, it's a bulldog.
Yeah, right,
guys?
I know, right?
Like old ladies walk up and go, I just love that talking tree. Oh my God. He's just cute. Isn't he cute?
I don't like his loudmouth little raccoon friend, but everything else is great.
Yeah, Rocket makes Lockjaw possible.
Yeah, that's totally true.
Yeah, that's very true.
If we hadn't had Rocket, I don't know that Ant-Man would have been possible, honestly.
Yeah. Well, and you have to look at it, too, and you wonder how much of all of a sudden there's this huge new wave of superhumans that doesn't lead into a Superhuman Registration Act in Captain America.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Who likes registering for anything, okay? you just go and be a superhero and then you gotta read the terms and conditions? You can't go do that. Come on. It's not gonna happen.
I'm not saying that, Eula. I'm not. I'm gonna do that. So, Dreamcast for Inhumans 2019, if it is the royal family, Black Bolt. What do you think?
I still like Vin Diesel.
I like Vin Diesel because he wouldn't have to talk.
His talking roles are so great, like the Iron Giant.
I am Groot.
I was gonna say, he should only allow to be talk on film when he's not actually in the film.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. He could be Lockjaw.
No. Here's your Black Bolt.
Yeah.
Gilbert Gottfried.
Ah! I love that!
Right.
Oh my God! Die, everybody! Die!
I'm sorry.
Because you know you have to have the scene at the end of the movie where, right at the climax of the movie, where he does have to speak to save the day, so all of a sudden you hear that Gilbert Gottfried voice.
Lockjaw. I'm casting it right now.
With Gilbert Gottfried?
No. It's motion cap.
It's mocap, yeah.
It's mocap. It's Paul Giamatti.
Paul Giamatti. Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, I can see that one.
But he would get really method.
Yeah.
He would be like, give me the dog food. I need it.
Finally, he could
play. Teleport out of here.
Medusa and her sister Crystal.
I'm not a crock.
Medusa, all right. And this is, I'm just going to go cultural for a minute because, Medusa, any black actress, because her hair, okay?
Jessica Williams.
Yeah, ain't no black woman gonna let somebody just mess around with her hair, so it should be just fine.
Yeah, yeah.
Angela Bassett, whatever she's doing, hit her up. Viola Davis, I know I pronounced that wrong. You know what? Whoopi Goldberg, whatever. I don't care. Just
make it happen.
Well, she is the speaker for the king. So, it'd have to be somebody super regal. I've had a hard time placing Medusa myself.
Beyonce.
There you go.
Emily Blunt, maybe?
Emily Blunt would be good.
Yeah.
You can't just go from Beyonce to Emily Blunt. You gotta wind down.
She's the British Beyonce.
No, but you kind of
just gotta stop and then go back to it later.
Yeah,
get back to that.
That's a hard transition.
I really like Blake Lively as Crystal.
I like that.
Yeah, I can see that.
That's good.
I can see that.
Or January Jones, I like.
What about Gordon?
Gorgon. No, he's already played Aquaman.
Oh,
okay. Oh, Momoa?
Yeah. I used to watch, when he was on Game of Thrones, I just used to pretend he was a centaur.
I think he actually is. They just CGI an actual human body on him.
I like that. Yeah, I like Momoa a lot.
Momoa would be good. Yeah. I could also see, he's here, Crixus.
Manu Bennett.
Manu Bennett doing that part.
That would be nice.
I would see Manu Bennett in that
role. He can do just about it. He can do anything.
Yeah.
He's good.
Tell me about it. No, but don't.
All right, Triton. Because he's kind of like...
Ape Sapien?
He's like Ape Sapien, yeah.
Anybody?
Just about any
skinny
dude.
Any circus.
Anybody?
James Lipton.
Okay.
Skinny dude that isn't allergic to stuff getting stuck on his face.
Yeah.
McLovin.
All right, Karnak.
Johnny Carson.
I might actually like Andy.
This is why we should be on panels together.
It's killing my hernia.
You really have a hernia?
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Killing it.
You have a legit hernia?
Yes.
Oh, round of applause for this man for playing through.
Yeah. Thank you.
That's something clearly inhuman going on in his body right now.
Maybe it's the butthole for reading my stomach. I don't know.
Jason Statham.
Jason Statham.
I want Jason Statham as Karnak. He goes, see? Your weak point is your throat, or we'll kick you in the throat.
Well, Jason Statham, I mean, Kevin Pollak has said that he's made a career out of saying three words in one syllable. Nami?
Nami.
Yeah, yeah.
So as long as that's all he has to say, he'd be fine.
Yeah, I mean, Ray Parks, maybe?
I like that.
Yeah, he could be good.
Ray Parks for Karnak?
Karnak is often drawn fairly Asian, at least as far as Jack Kirby could draw Asian. So I thought Jet
Li. Which was
Li.
A little racist.
Yeah, a little bit, just a touch. I thought Jet Li would be a good one.
Or how about when I'm casting Asian, I'm always want to throw in a Stone, Amanda Stone.
What? Oh, I see what you did.
I see what you're doing.
Emma Stone, yeah.
Emma Stone.
I see what you did there.
I see what you did there.
All right. Well, let's
Google it later.
Let's pull that microphone out and let everybody ask us questions. Remember, none of us write Inhumans, so but you can ask us anything you want to know about it. Any other questions you have about Inhumans? We got a microphone up here.
I don't think it works. But I'll just come
relax.
Up here and use this microphone. Anyone?
Bueller.
All right, let's talk more about Black Agar.
So check this
you
out.
You brought this on yourself.
Black Agar was born in the mean streets of the moon.
Come on. Grab a mic. Tell us something you love about the Inhumans. Ask us a question you'd like to hear. Say something stupid about.
There we go.
There we go. Yeah.
What?
Well,
does that
have
to be Inhumans or heaven?
Whatever you want.
Let's just have a conversation.
Hey, you paid to be here, dude.
If you don't, we have to talk more about Black Agar.
Please have a question.
Sure. Mine's just mainly, last time I was in a panel just like this, like 6 months ago, it was a lot about Ant-Man. Mm-hmm. What was your thoughts on Ant-Man? And how he's going to be in the new Avengers.
What are our thoughts on Ant-Man and how he's going to be in the new Avengers? All right.
What was our thoughts before Ant-Man came out?
Our thought was we got the raccoon through.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Every time, like if you listen to the Geek Show, every time we brought up Ant-Man, I would just be Garrett Morris for that Saturday Night Live. It's like, all right, more stuff on Ant-Man. I was like, Ant-Man. What's your powers, Ant-Man?
Honestly, I think, and this is just my thoughts. You know, I drink a lot of whiskey, and I went to a lot of online colleges, so I don't know anything. I went to four. Anyways, I think they're going to utilize him. He's going to be one of those role players where he's going to probably have to steal an Infinity Stone. You know what I mean? Because I mean, like, the way they sold him was like it's a heist movie, and that's what I love so much about Ant-Man because I loved heist movies. And so I think that's the way that he's probably going to be stealing something. You know, he's going to be doing behind enemy lines. You know, bitch slap Thanos in the back of the head or something like that. Sorry, language. My bad. But I mean, like, that's probably how they're going to utilize him, in my personal opinion.
Yeah, and the movie in particular utilizes a lot of the character traits that are the Nick Spencer's using in his current run.
Which is fantastic.
It really is.
Yeah.
You should be reading. I know it sounds weird, but you should be reading Ant-Man.
You should be reading Ant-Man.
And next month, Astonishing Ant-Man number 1 comes out. But yeah, my guess is that's where they're going to be taking a lot of the direction from. So and we've already seen that they have taken a lot from him. So I would look to that as kind of a.
Well, actually, this last issue, The Last Days of Ant-Man,
that preceded
Secret War, you could read that by itself.
Yep, absolutely.
It's so good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, I'm a big Ant-Man fan. I like every incarnation of Ant-Man that has come through. When they first announced it was going to be Ant-Man, you know, I just said, it has to be Scott. It has to be Scott Lang. There's no way around it. Hank Pym has too much baggage and doesn't really make sense.
Yeah, but I was just so happy we got a Hank Pym.
Yeah, it was perfect.
And they did this whole legacy of heroes thing. I really like that.
So they totally took the plot of the legend of, or the Mask of Zorro.
We need a lot more Janet, I agree.
Put it into Ant-Man.
Yeah.
I thought it was really funny. It's my kind of humor. I know Paul Rudd wrote a lot of that. I think he and I would totally get along. The sarcastic one-liner.
He's mine!
Is really my
All right.
And as a father myself, I was also able to really relate.
Yeah.
And so it really came out as I walked out of there thinking, that is my kind of movie, my kind of humor, my kind of superhero, and it was perfect, and I'm really excited to see him fanboy out when he meets the other Avengers.
Cool.
Shannon, do you want to answer that?
You have an answer?
It was a test. You guys go.
All right. What's
so?
Dude, just use this mic. Just come up here. Just
come up
it.
Here and leave.
I need everybody in the back to hear your question, please. Sorry, I didn't mean to be that guy.
Because Jay has to repeat it, otherwise, he's that guy.
Black
Yeah, he's black enough.
Thank
he's
you.
Black Bolt is the king.
There you go. Use Jay's mic.
So he's the king of the Inhumans.
Right here, dude. Like this to watch.
Like you're dating it.
Yeah. All right, so he can't talk. I just want to know, how does he communicate with anybody?
Good question.
Good question. How does Black Bolt communicate with everybody?
I know
this answer.
Give it to us.
It's not interpretive dance.
It should
it's actually,
be.
It's actually fairly close.
See, he's got this dog that was once a man.
So, when Black Bolt first went through Terra Genesis, they had to lock him in a soundproof room because he whispered in his sleep and it destroyed half the city. I mean, that's how powerful his voice is. He breathes in your ear and you blow up. I watched him do it. It was a Skrull, so it was okay. No, but seriously, so Medusa had pity on him, and she would come and visit him every single day, and they developed their own sort of sign language to where really they are the... Medusa really is the only one that can interpret Black Bolt, and it gets to a point where simple looks of expression... And she got to know him so well that she just speaks for him now. He speaks through her, and they use their very own special kind of sign language that they developed. With
that no other member of the royal family in the 50 or 60 years of Inhumans has figured out.
Yep. Yeah. They do a lot. They do a lot of it in private, and they do that intentionally.
Yes.
But good question.
Good question. Next. Please talk into the microphone. It's awesome.
What's your favorite Inhuman?
Who's your favorite Inhuman?
How you doing, young man?
Okay, I as much as I've been making jokes, Lockjaw, hands down, if you've read Chris Eliopoulos's Pet Avengers.
Yes.
It's so good.
It is good.
It is so good. And he's like the perfect character in there.
And he's awesome in that.
Awesome.
And also in Ms. Marvel.
Yo,
when he showed up in Ms. Marvel and Kamala she turns and looks at this gigantic dog and you think she's going to freak out. And the next panel she's, what a cute big dog. And she takes him home. Can I keep him? I love Lockjaw. Lockjaw's my favorite.
Yeah, I do like Lockjaw, and I'm not just saying this just because it's... Because
it's your name now?
Yes, it's my name now. It's always been my name. I always knew there was something different about me. it really is Black Bolt. Like, it's just because of that... that scene that I read when he went toe-to-toe with Hulk on the moon.
World War Hulk.
Great. Like, I mean, and if you never read World War Hulk, it's 56 pages of punching and onomatopoeia. It's so fantastic. It's just pow, whack, boom,
crack,
whatever sound the moon makes when it like bursts into two pieces, like whatever that noise is. I think it's called child support, whatever. He'll explain later. I hope you never understand what I'm talking about. But I mean, like, Black Bolt is my man just because he can go toe to toe with the Hulk. Honestly.
Yeah. See, and I always love Gorgon, man. Yeah. I love Gorgon.
Cool.
Because he's like half, like, he's, you know, he's a kind of a centaur thing.
He's Saturn. Yeah.
And he can stomp on the floor, make earthquakes and stuff.
And he's
cool.
Super tough, too.
And he drinks too much and he eats too much.
Something he'll deal with later.
Your dream.
Yeah, the really cool thing about the Inhumans is, unlike other superhero teams, each one fits into this kind of house of cards where they're really not complete when they're not with each other.
That's true.
And so you ask this question, who's your favorite? And so far we've heard the same person say three times that three different Inhumans are their favorite because just kind of depending on the situation of where they're at.
Well, they do.
It's really hard. They tend to write them very well.
They recently did a series with Karnak where, not the Johnny Carson version, where he wound up out in New York just seeing the flaws in everything and just going crazy. Oh, yeah, and it killed him. It was killing him, and it was amazing. It was an amazing series.
Good jumping on point again in October. James Robison of Starman is going to write a new Karnak comic.
Oh, we'll nice.
Hold on, that's going to be awesome.
Warren Ellis wrote
And Charles Soule is continuing his Inhuman run, and it has been amazing.
Who wrote the series of Inhumans that Jay Lee illustrated? That was so good.
I don't know.
Bendis, I don't know.
No, it was a long time ago.
It was a long time ago.
Hey, real quick, can I ask these young men, because they asked us to...
Yeah.
You know, Aiden and Dash, cool names, by the way. Who are your favorites? Please tell us. I want to know.
Yeah.
Triton.
Yeah. Do you have at least one black girl friend in your school?
All right. Thanks, guys. We're done.
Hey, guys, I'm going to say the same thing. Hey, if you go to, and I'm just throwing this out here, if you go to a panel and you have a good time on the at the panel, get on Facebook,
Twitter,
whatever. Say some nice stuff about the con.
Yeah.
There's so much negative stuff on the internet, and I know we're having a great time. Fill the internet with love for Comic-Con because it rules.